what I hope that my father would have said and would have felt is that, Ron, I'm very proud of you, and I'm very proud of what you've done, and I'm very proud of the fact that you hope that it will be used for the betterment of the human race.
Every single one of us has a big story. Events that make us who we are, shape us, inform what we do with our lives, who we become. These big stories are simply extraordinary, defining moments that make or break people. From them, we can learn, empathise and connect. These are the turning points that change people's lives. These stories must be told, starting right now. Professor Ron Mallett is one of the world's leading physicists, his specialty, time travel. He says not only is it possible, he knows how to do it.
My interest in time travel came as a result of a major tragedy that happened in my family when I was very young. I grew up in the Bronx, New York. My father was a television repairman. And for me, I was the oldest of four children. And for me, the sun rose and set on him. And he gave me scientific toys like gyroscope and crystal radio set. And he spent a lot of time with me. And I think he eventually wanted me to go into the business with him. Now, he looked very healthy. He looked robust. We didn't know he had a weak heart. And he died suddenly of a massive heart attack when he was only 33. I was 10 at the time. And it completely devastated my life. I went from being a really happy, gregarious kid to becoming depressed. And I really didn't care whether I lived or died after he died. But I did love reading, and about a year after he died, I came across the book that changed my life. It was the Classics Illustrated version of H.G. Wells' classic, The Time Machine. And in it, at the very first page, it said, scientific people know very well that time is just a kind of space, and we can move forward and backward in time just as we can in space. And when I saw those words, it was like a life preserver. I thought, wait a minute, if it's possible to go back in time, then maybe if I had a time machine, I could go back to the past and see him again and maybe save his life. So that became a passion for me. I thought that I might be able to put something together that looked like the cover on the magazine that had H.G. Wells' story, The Time Machine. And of course, I had bicycle parts and old television parts of my father and everything. And of course, nothing, it didn't work. But I remember that it said, scientific people know very well. And I knew that I was going to have to know something about science. I wasn't sure exactly what, but I knew it was going to have to be. And the one time I remember, I saw this paperback book, and it had a picture of Einstein on it. Now, I knew Einstein was this great genius. I knew that something was interesting about him from another standpoint, because he died in the same year that my father died. He actually died a month earlier, in April of 1955. But I didn't know exactly what he did, but he was standing next to an hourglass. In my mind, I thought, maybe Einstein has something to say about time. So I got the paperback, and even though it was a popular version, I still picked up the essence. The essence was is that unlike the old physics of Newton, where the river of time flows and you cannot change it in any way, according to Einstein, there are ways you could alter time. And I thought, wait a minute, if Einstein, this great genius, is saying that there's ways of altering time, then I have to understand what he has to say, because that might lead to the possibility of a time machine. So Einstein became my second passion.
Ron couldn't afford college, so he joined the army. Once he finished serving, he was eligible for subsidized university education. He got his PhD in physics, specializing in Einstein's theory of relativity. For years, he worked on the theory of time travel. And when he had his breakthrough, the world listened.
What I did was I solved Einstein's gravitational field equations for a special type of light, laser light. And my breakthrough was that if gravity can affect time and light can create gravity, then light can affect time. So that what I realized is that laser light could actually alter time. And a special type of laser light, there is a real device that's called a ring laser. It's simply, if you imagine a square and imagine a corner at each end of the square, the four corners of the square, and imagine a bouncing a beam of light from one mirror to the X mirror to the next mirror so that you create sort of like a circulating beam of laser light. You can imagine that circulating beam of light as being like the spoon, and you can imagine the area that the circulating beam of light is in is like the coffee in the cup. So the circulating light beam will cause a stirring of empty space, just like the spoon causing the stirring of the coffee. This means that anything that's in it will get twisted. If you have enough energy, that twisting of space by the circulating light beam will cause a twisting of time into a loop. So you could create loops in time by using a circulating beam of laser light. And once you have these loops in time, you could potentially travel back into the past. Now, I was interested not in traveling back into the past, but sending information back to the past. In some sense, sending information back to the past is even more important than traveling back to the past. Imagine, for example, catastrophes like earthquakes, tsunamis. If I could send information back to the past to warn myself of that, these things could save thousands of lives, maybe millions of lives. Is this possible? Yes, it is. But how can it be done? Well, part of the problem is that the experiment, I'm a theoretical physicist, I should mention. Einstein was a theoretical physicist. He came up with the famous equation equals mc squared. He did not build nuclear reactors. He was not responsible for the experiments with the atomic energy. He sent a letter to Roosevelt saying the possibility, but he was not involved in any experiments. That's done by another area in physics called experimental physics. And I'm not an experimental physicist. I've solved these equations, but to have the equipment to do it, it's just like with the equals mc squared. In order to turn that into real atomic energy requires funding. So the one realistic thing that I should mention is that scientific experiments are very, very expensive. So circulating beam of light experiment has not been done. Mathematically, I've been able to show these effects, but financially, that's something that hasn't yet been done. But it is possible in principle for that to happen. But the limitation is that you cannot have the loop go back earlier than the time the device was turned on. As I said, this happens for any process. For example, if I turned it on today and left it on for, let's say, 10 years, I could send back information 7 years, 5 years, all the way back up to the time that the machine was turned on, but I can't send information earlier than that. What this means is that when time travel does occur, it will have that limitation. We will not be able to visit our ancestors, but our descendants will be able to visit us. And that will allow us, that means that the future of mankind will be able to control their destiny up to the point that it was formed, which is another motivation for trying to create a time machine sooner than later. The decision is for us to make about how much we wish to control our destiny. Personally, I feel that we will be able to use it and we will find ways of regulating it for the betterment of the human race. And that is a wonderful thing. For me personally, the quest that I had was to show that this is possible. And for me, the satisfaction I get is that my father would have been proud of what I have been able to accomplish, even if I am not able to get a chance to see him again. I have to say that one of the things that really I'm very proud of, I gave a talk at an international meeting, was the International Association for Relativistic Dynamics, shortly after my breakthrough. And the people that were in this meeting were people who were my peers. These are experts in Einstein's theory of relativity. And it had some really top guns there. And one of them was a man who was at that particular time the director of the Center of Relativity at the University of Texas in Austin. His name was Bryce DeWitt. And at the end of my talk, I gave a fully technical talk. However, at the end of my talk, I did something that's usually not done at technical talks. I talked about my motivation for being interested in the possibility of time travel. And one of the things that still to this day is very important to me is the fact that during the question and answer period that came, DeWitt could have said this to me privately, But he said this publicly during the question and answer period. And DeWitt was someone that everyone in that audience admired and respected. He said, "I don't know if you'll see your father again, but he would have been proud of you." And I can't tell you how much that meant. It brought it all together for me.